This show is strictly for educational purposes. The opinions expressed on the show are personal to the individuals appearing in the show and not those of Thinking Tree Ecoholics Private Limited. The show is not intended to offend or defame any individual, entity, caste, community, race, or religion, or to denigrate any institution, person, living or dead. Listener discretion is strongly advised.
Hello and welcome to the Thinking Tree. I am Kritika. And today we have with us Dr. Govind Bhattacharji, former professor of the Indian Institute of Public Administration, who retired as Director General from the Office of the Comptroller and Auditor General of India, New Delhi, in 2018. He has been a civil servant for more than 3 decades, with many important positions and assignments both in India and abroad. He is a prolific writer on a wide variety of subjects, ranging from economics and public policy to popular science. So my first question to you is, there have been a slew of measures taken in the recent past to address the issue of black money, demonetization and GST, to name a few. However, your article on the agricultural income states that exempting agricultural income from the ambit of income tax has led to huge evasions. And clearly, evaders have found new ways to skip paying taxes. So where do you think India currently stands on account of black money?
Okay. First, let us try to identify the sectors, you know, that absorb black money. One is real estate, the other is agriculture. There could be others as well, like gold, but I think these two are the most important. You see, black money, you know, to curb black money was one of the objectives of demonetization. And because real estate was one of the greatest absorbers of black money, so demonetization wanted to curb the use of black money in real estate by curtailing the use of cash. And indeed, immediately after demonetization, the price of real estate sector did come down a little, but I don't think it was followed up properly. You see, the absorption of black money with the real estate, it pushes up the prices of the assets, you know, much beyond their intrinsic real values. Demonetization wanted to address this, and especially the secondary market, where the ratio between legal money and black money was 60 to 40, and probably it is still so. Now, remember that, you know, the demonetization came in November 2016, and a few months later, in July 2017, the GST was launched. So natural and logical step after demonetization, if you wanted to curb the use of black money in real estate, would have been to bring real estate under the GST. But it was not done. It was not done, not simply because the state governments objected, because they would be losing their powers to levy stamp duty and registration fees, but because there was a huge lobby of politicians and others who found real estate sector an ideal place for hiding their black money. So it was not done. Today, you pay only the stamp duty and registration fees on your transactions on the real estate. But because of the involvement of this element of black money, the real value of the transaction is concealed. Now, after real estate, the next biggest absorber of black money is agriculture. Now, you see, there is no tax on agriculture income. So a person, a farmer who earns income only from agriculture, has no liability to report his income to the income tax department. And therefore, he has no obligation to maintain accounts also. Because if there is no reporting, there is no need to maintain an account. Only a person who has income from sources other than agriculture, only such a person has a liability to report the agricultural income if it's more than 5,000, but only for the purpose of determining the slab rate of his taxation. Suppose, including agricultural income, his total income goes into a higher slab of taxation, then he will be charged that higher rate on his non-agricultural income only, while he'll be claiming exemption and given exemption on his agricultural income. Now, I have shown using CAG reports, which was initiated by me, that the income tax department lacks a robust machinery, a robust mechanism to validate these exemptions. And the exemptions claimed in many cases are fictitious. So You see, the because there is lack of control, absolute lack of control, I'll say, laxity of controls, that's what makes agriculture an ideal absorber of black money. The only way we can prevent the use of black money in agriculture, is by bringing agriculture into the taxation net, which is what I have argued for. But given the present, you know, I mean, the agitation against the farm bills, which I think is a very progressive measure, I don't think any government will dare to impose a levy on agriculture income in the foreseeable future, probably not in our lifetime. You see, demonetization was based on the premise that once black money is sucked out of the market, the sectors which absorb black money will be forced to correct their prices downwards. That will lead to a fall in inflation. And the money that will now find its way into the formal stream, formal banking channels, as it did indeed after demonetization, they will contribute to future taxes. Because it will be easier for the income tax department, any taxation department, to track that money. Now, the fall in inflation and this future growth in taxation together will contribute to the growth of the economy. And this growth outpace the loss of growth after demonetization. But it does not happen for various reasons. Now, we must understand that the factors underlying black money are not economic or technical. They are basically political. And that will take us to the root of the problem, that is electoral funding. Now, today, we have limits on what a candidate can spend, but we have no limits on what a political party can spend. We have taken some baby steps like electoral bonds and other things, you know. But I think till the time you bring in absolute transparency in the system of electoral funding, this problem of black money is not going to be cured.
There's a huge lag as of now, and there have to be many measures to curb that. And though we are taking steps, but it's going to take a long time to reach there.
Yes. It will.
My second question to you, sir, is Thomas Friedman, in his book, The World is Flat, has quoted that capitalism makes people unequally rich, but socialism makes them equally poor. I was very fascinated with this sentence. So your article on capitalism with ethics also talks about the merits of capitalism. However, India since independence has had an overwhelming state control over economy in the Soviet style. So clearly it is time for some changes. Do you think capitalism is much needed today? And if yes, what sectors are especially in need of it?
Okay, Kritika, you see, Adam Smith's Wealth of Nations, you know, it fundamentally altered the way people thought about economics and the relations between the state, society, and the individual. It proclaimed that a nation could increase its wealth in an unlimited manner by the use of capital, which is actually the profits of business recycled back into business. So capital became the ebb and flow of wealth, and yearning for profit, which was hitherto considered a vice, was no longer a vice. It was a benevolent force for society. And capitalism said that the invisible hand of the market, where competition is free and fair, is capable of solving most of the problems of society. And therefore, market became God. Market assumed the status of God. And the governments only existed to ensure that the market remained free from intervention and that competition remained free and fair. But the pitfalls of capitalism are too well known to allow the market free reign. In fact, market offers no protection against exploitation. It has no ethics, it has no soul. And the capitalist greed for unlimited profit has killed millions all over the world with a cold indifference, and probably it is still doing so. Now, in India, after independence, instead of the market, we started a system of state capitalism, which has given us a huge, oversized, badly managed public sector, and a Hindu rate of growth for the first 40 years after independence, till we realized the dangers of it and started relaxing our controls over the economy. But we did not relax the controls over the public sector. If we gave them any autonomy, it was only a name. in substance, it was never given. Now, I'm not arguing that there is a need for wholesale privatization of the public sector, or even that, you know, we should be hiving of the most. We must keep the valid ones, but not in the present form. If we keep them, we must give them real autonomy by creating an appropriate holding structure. Now, coming back to capitalism, you see, I mean, I have mentioned, and you know, it is held by most, that despite its negative connotations, the capitalism's power to create mass prosperity and to change life positively, that remains undisputed. Capitalism has survived many challenges. It has faced many crises. It has, you know, outlived communism, the Great Depression, and in our time, the global economic meltdown. And from each crisis, it is much stronger with remarkable resilience. We certainly need capitalism for our growth and prosperity, but then we don't need capitalism in the present form, where it keeps on creating inequality and keeps on plunging the world from one crisis into another. The problem before us, I think, is how to root capitalism in justice, ethics, and morality, where profit will not be the only bottom line to follow, where it will not be the be-all and end-all of all our economic activities, but only a constraint to satisfy. The problem before us is how to transform capitalism to make it socially more responsible, economically more equitable, and environmentally more sustainable as it extracts and converts the natural resources into profits. The profits will have to be there. They will be there. But then I think the new age of capitalism, the companies will be voluntarily sharing more and more of the profits for social welfare and increasingly turning towards becoming not-for-profit companies. They do exist, and they do not exist badly. Now, you see, if this pandemic and the lockdown, if the lockdown has made one thing apparent to all of us, it is this, that we can live with very, very little, that we don't need, you know, unlimited profit to add substance and quality to our lives. We can live with very little. That's the lockdown. That's the lesson of pandemic. And if capitalism can imbibe the lesson of pandemic, then the companies can become and survive and sustain themselves as not-for-profit companies. I think that requires a paradigm shift in thinking. But I think the time is right for that. The companies may be thinking about this already, or they will be forced to think about this.
So it's more or less, we have to reduce the government's control and give more liberty, but not give so much liberty that there should be exploitation when it comes to capitalism. Okay.
Absolutely. So, absolutely.
My next question to you is, it's in continuation to the last question. PSUs in India were an extension of the socialist ideology. However, today they contribute heavily towards India's fiscal deficit. And this, of course, demands for the current disinvestment streak. Do you think India is ready for the situation where government stops doing business altogether and just remains the regulator?
You see, we have got about 400 plus public sector companies. I mean, not reckoning the 200 plus deemed government companies, where the central government, along with the state government or with another government company, holds the majority share. Now, of these 400 plus companies, let's say 400 public sector enterprises, about half of them, they earn profit. The rest, I mean, incur losses. Now, if you look into the balance sheet of these companies, you realize one startling truth, that of the profit-making companies, only 10 top profit-making companies account for about 65% of the total profits earned by all the profit-making companies. And about the loss-making companies, you see that the top 10 loss-making companies, among them Air India, MTNL, BSNL, and some coal companies, they account for 85% of the total losses incurred by all the loss-making companies. So if you can sell off these 10 companies, you reduce 85% of your losses. Of course, selling them won't be easy, as we're learning from our experience with Air India. Who would like to buy a loss-making company? But then the quantum, you know, of the problem, you can guess from this. Coming to employment again, you see the top 20 companies they also include some loss-making companies. They account for 75% of the total employment in the public sector. So whether for the purpose of revenue or for the purpose of employment, you don't need to keep 400 companies. Only a handful of companies will give you profit and provide for employment. Now, that's about the central sector. Now, if you come to the state sector, the picture is, of course, entirely different. In the state sector, we have got about 1,100 plus state government public undertakings. 95% of them, incur losses only. Many of them are dysfunctional. They have ceased operation decades ago, but they cannot be liquidated because they have no accounts and you don't know their assets and liabilities. Most of them are the so-called welfare companies, welfare of the backward caste, welfare of scheduled caste, scheduled tribes, welfare of this and welfare of that. Now, these companies, these welfare companies, they don't produce anything. They only give loans to these sections for whose welfare they have been set up and earn interest. This purpose can be done much more efficiently by any bank or financial institution, existing financial institutions. You don't need to create them. You create them because you want to give cushy parking spaces to your bureaucrats and MLAs. So they have no reason to exist. But without them, many governments will fall instantly. Because the bureaucrats and MLAs who are employed there as CMDs, chairman, managing directors, they're given, ministerial privileges like cars, accommodation, etc., which continue to bleed the state financially. And this aberration is continuing since a number of decades. And I don't know, for how long it will continue more. Now, coming to your question about, fiscal deficit. In fact, since 1992, the public sector companies have been used to finance the fiscal deficits. And they, in fact, finance up to 20% of the fiscal deficits. For example, for last year, the initial budget estimate for the fiscal deficit was 7.96 lakh, let's say 8 lakh crore. And the public sector disinvestment was supposed to have brought in 2 lakh crore. So without the public sector disinvestment, the fiscal deficit would have been 10 lakh crore. So 20% of this was meant to be bridged by the disinvestment of public sector. It's another matter that we got only 30,000 crore instead of 2 lakh crore. And even this year also, they have kept a target of 1.75 lakh crore from disinvestment, which I don't think will be, it'll be difficult to achieve that target. But, disinvestment is not the only way the central government uses the public sector. You see, there's a policy of DIPAM which says that if a company has surplus cash, then it must buy back its shares. Now, buying back its shares means you give out the cash to the government for buying back your own shares. Nothing changes. The control of the government over the company doesn't change. Nothing changes. Only the company is drained out of its cash. Some companies are even forced to buy other sick companies. So nothing changes. But the companies are drained of their cash. They have no money sometimes, for their working capital. So they have to borrow for their working capital and even to pay salaries to their staff. Now, these kind of aberrations cannot stop unless you separate the government's role as owner, regulator, and policymaker. Many countries have done so. And in doing so, they have rejuvenated their public sector and transformed many of their public sector companies to become global giants. Now, if you want to separate the role of the government as owner, as regulator, and as policymaker, then you need to create a structure between the government and the public sector. It's a holding company. Now, there's a useful model before us from Singapore. It's called the Temasek model. You see, Singapore in 1970s faced the same problems with the public sector that we've been facing for years now. It was saddled with a huge oversized public sector that was making losses. And there were corruption issues also. So what the government did was that they created a holding company called Temasek Holdings and transferred the government shares of the public sector to this company. So Temasek became the owner. So in that capacity, Temasek managed the companies, these public sector companies, by appointing to their boards experts, technical experts, and qualified managers, and not bureaucrats and, you know, politicians. They are not being appointed to their boards like we are doing now. So that was, you know, the separating the role of the, and Temasek remained responsible to the government for the policy implementation and for payment of dividends. So the role of the government as owner and, you know, I mean, policymaker was separated. The regulatory functions were exercised by a body called ACRA, the Accounting and Corporate Regulatory Authority, which is much like our register of companies, but with much, much wider scope and power. So you see the three functions, regulation, policymaking, and ownership, they have been separated by creating a structure between the government and the public sector, which shields the public sector from direct government interference. Whereas while the holding company remains responsible for implementation of the government policy. We can adopt the same structure. It has been suggested earlier also, but no government has acted on it. You see, the primary task of the government is policymaking, and it should remain limited to that. Now, if you want to really revive the public sector, even if you disinvest, you know, the ones, you know, in the non-strategic sector, even then you'll be having some company. You have to have some company, some public sector with you. If you want to revive them, really make them efficient, then you must de-bureaucratize them, de-politicize them. Some developed countries, you know, they specifically debar their bureaucrats and politicians from being appointed to the board of the public sector companies. But in our country, it's a different story altogether. So unless you restrict the government's role to policymaking, nothing is going to change.
To sum up your answer, public sector companies need to be there, but we have to get rid of the top loss-making companies, and we have to do a cost-benefit analysis there and get rid of the top loss-making companies and just make it more efficient is the option in front of us right now.
That's partly yes. And, but mostly it is separate in the role of the government, you know, as a regulator, owner, and policymaker.
Yes. So in continuation to that question, sir, because we are on the topic of saving so that it can be invested in a better place, there's a huge debate surrounding one nation, one election. Both pros and cons carry a lot of weight. So what is your opinion on this?
Well, as you rightly said, you know, both the pros and cons carry lots of weight. In fact, you know, I'll say that, you know, I mean, why I'll say this is a fact that... Till 1967, simultaneous election to the Lok Sabha and assemblies, that was the norm. The norm was broken with the Congress government, you know, in 1968, when they dissolved some of the assemblies, and again in 1969, and then finally the Lok Sabha in December 1970. So since then, the elections have got, you know, out of sync. And I think during the last 30 years, there was hardly any year where we didn't have any election. Now, if you have to have an election every year, then it affects development in many ways. First, think about the election, what you mentioned. The expenses. You see, in the last election, last Lok Sabha election, 2019 Lok Sabha election, the estimated expenditure was ₹60,000 crore. 10,000 by the election commission, 10,000 crore by the election commission, and 50,000 crore by the political parties. Much of it black money. And much of it, you know, abused in distribution of freebies like liquor and et cetera, In the state elections, of course, we don't need that much of money. But even then, given our stage of development, we cannot afford to, spend huge sums of money every year on elections. That's a major argument. The second argument, is about the security. The security forces have their primary duty to preserve the internal security of the country. But for every election they're deployed, and for those states where elections are held over multiple phases, like Bihar and West Bengal, they're deployed for extended periods of time that distract them from their primary duty of internal security. Thirdly, think about the governance. Every minister, the prime minister and all the ministers, you know, they're permanently in a campaigning mode. You know, because there are elections every year, yeah, sometimes more than one, and that distract them heavily from their developmental duties, from the duty of policymaking. It affects governance. Not to mention the code of conduct that kicks in, you know, whenever election is announced, which makes the government enormously dysfunctional, leading to policy paralysis. And another important, issue is that, during every election time, you find the cleavages in our society, the fissures in our society, they come to the fore, because every party wants to exploit those issues, caste, religion, community, etc., to their advantage. And they'll rake up issues, which are better forgotten. So the less the election that you have, the less we have these issues. And black money, of course, I've mentioned about it. But for all this, and there are other issues as well. So for all these issues, various agencies, from the election commission to the law commission, have deliberated, from time to time about the possibility of holding simultaneous election to the Lok Sabha and the assemblies. Now, there have been various suggestions that have been proffered from time to time. Some suggestions were for, holding an election of a legislature, if it's dissolved midway, only for the remainder of the term. Somebody said some suggestions were for president's rule. If a legislature gets dissolved midway, then we impose president's rule for the rest of the term. Now that is against the federal spirit of the constitution. And therefore, I think there's a parliamentary committee on law and justice that recommended a two-phase election, one concurrent with the Lok Sabha election and the other midway through its term. And I think in 2019, the central government had invited about 40 parties to discuss the issues. Half of them attended and no consensus emerged. No consensus emerged because all the parties are scared. They apprehend that if you have elections simultaneously to the Lok Sabha and the assemblies, then it will tend to perpetuate a single party rule. Because you see, what happens is that, the issues before a national election and the issues for a state election, they're entirely different. One is local, one is national. If you have the elections simultaneously, then the national issues tend to eclipse the state issues. As a result, the local and regional parties which advocate the state issues, they tend to get marginalized. As it is, they're at a huge disadvantage compared to the national parties. They don't have the resources. And if the elections are held together, then the national parties, they tend to reap the advantages. And it can perpetuate a single party rule, yes. But I think, more than this, more than the issue of holding simultaneous election to the Lok Sabha state assemblies, what is more important is to look at the nature of the elections. Now, you see, democracy is a rule by the consent of the majority. But in none of the elections has the ruling party, even including Nehru's time, in none of the elections has the ruling party ever got more than 50% of the votes polled. The closest we came to was in 1984, when Congress under Rajiv Gandhi secured only 48% of the total votes poll. I think the present government has, NDA has about 45% of the vote share. In our country, a party with 20% vote share has produced a prime minister. From 1991 to 2014, I think the majority party, the most important party in the ruling coalition, had less than 30% votes. So I think, it's the irony. And, I think, more than the issue of holding simultaneous elections to the Lok Sabha and the state assemblies, it is this issue. You should change this system. If you want to reform the electoral system, you must change it from our first past the post system to a system of proportional representation, where our assemblies and parliament will truly represent the popular will and will create a more vibrant democracy.
Thank you so much, sir, for answering all our questions. These questions are very popularly asked by our students, but when you see news channels and when you see newspapers, it's evident that their opinion is very biased. And for a student to form the right opinion is very important because they are the future of the country. So thank you for giving us that opinion. It was really great. Do you have any final words for Ecoholics?
Well, you see, I think, a live learning platform, Ecoholics, it bridges a huge gap in our existing system. Because in the rural areas, you have a problem of access, to quality to learning material. And I think, by providing them, at affordable, their costs, and making them accessible and deliverable over the online platforms, you are bridging a huge gap huge existing gap in society. And, you know, may God bless you in your endeavor. I thank you for, inviting me to your Thinking Tree platform. It was a singular honor. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, sir. It was great having you, and we are really grateful that you spent so much time with us, and you talked about all these important issues with us, and I'm sure it's going to be a lot of help to our viewers. Thank you so much for being with us here today, sir.
Thank you, Kritika. It was a pleasure. God bless you.